Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Penn State's Department of Architecture lecture series. My name is Merdad Hadigi. I'm the head of the department, and we are super pleased to welcome Liz Ogbu to our series tonight. I want to extend my gratitude first to Liz, but also to two of our faculty, Marcus and DK, for organizing the series and putting all of this together, and also to the Stuckeman School for helping us put the series together. I'm going to pass the baton, the proverbial baton, the virtual baton, to my colleague, DK Oseo-Asare, who will do the introduction. Liz, thank you again, and thank you everybody else for joining us tonight. DK, all yours.
Thank you, Merdad, and good evening, everyone. And Liz, you're welcome. Thank you. Welcome here to Penn State, to the Stuckeman School and Department of Architecture, our community. Thank you also for all the behind the scenes effort to make this conversation possible. I feel like we started this conversation a couple of years ago, maybe around 2020 or thereabouts. And really since that time, obviously compounded by the COVID-19 pandemic, although the distribution of the pandemic's impacts globally are already becoming unequal, or at least we can say maybe not the same, but there has been since that time really an enormous tension throughout the United States emerging from deep and fractious fault lines of politics, competing economic frameworks, paradigms of race and class relations, both in this country and with entanglements worldwide that extend, to use a term that I may very well have learned from you, Liz, the sort of social dimensions of the built environment. Everyone, not only in America, but indeed in the Americas, can sense the need for system change, even if in different ways and for different reasons, with varying degrees of intensity and urgency, and with various forms and attitudes competing to emerge as dominant in terms of how near-term futures are programmed, designed, constructed, and implemented. These are the reasons why Liz, her time, experience, knowledge, and expertise, and if I may say, energy, are in demand right now at kind of peak levels. And this in itself exposes certain other system challenges that we face collectively as a society. Namely, how do we learn from and amplify the voices of change makers like Liz? How do we reinvent the design disciplines and design professions, what we call design, and how we practice it together? How do we retool these frameworks, models, methods, techniques, and conventions for the 21st century? What makes Liz visionary precisely at this moment in time is her leadership in forging jointly new paradigms and new pathways for architecture, conceived perhaps more broadly or maybe in more inclusive terms, as human experience and space in the environment. And not to put the cart ahead of the horse, but I want to sort of maybe plant this first question out there, Liz, which may be that, you know, on how and in what ways you may view your practice in relation to some of the terms that Liz actually helped to mainstream in architecture, terms like public interest design and sort of design for social impact. Earlier this week, I checked my email sort of for today's event, and I sort of rediscovered this cascade of all these emails with Liz that go back, so let's just say way back. And you know, Liz earned a Master's of Architecture degree from the Harvard Graduate School of Design, and before that, a Bachelor of Arts from Wellesley College with an interdepartmental major of art and architecture. And when she was at the GSD, she led a student group that was somehow called SOCA. Originally it was sort of Students of Color Association. It became Social Change and Activism. This is how I first met Liz, and she agreed to come back not just once, but I think at least twice or more to give talks even then, including a conference called Systems for Inclusion with Shigeru Ban and Urban Think Tank and a bunch of other folks in this space. In addition, between her undergraduate and graduate studies, Liz completed a Thomas J. Watson Fellowship which was really kind of not toward a, let's say, across sub-Saharan Africa, where she spent time, at least along this sort of experience, in conversation or somehow an internship with a late architect and builder by the name of Alero Olimpio. And Alero was also a mentor of mine. She was really somehow Ghanaian, Togolese, Jamaican, Scottish, but she was, for all extents and purposes, really the godmother of sustainable design in West Africa. So I wanted to acknowledge that link and somehow also thank Auntie Alero for her influence. Liz also participated in an inaugural symposium on Alero's work and philosophy at Wellesley College, which was a kind of precursor to the rediscovery of some of Alero's work, including most recently a sort of inaugural annual lecture series at the Institute for African Futures in Accra. As part of her journey toward new models of design practice, Liz served as design director at the nonprofit organization Public Architecture, where she worked to develop new models of design in the public interest. She was then, I want to say maybe even one of the inaugural, but she was a sort of early innovator in residence at IDEO.org. IDEO is an industry-leading corporate sort of design firm that has championed many of the current trends around design thinking in business and new product development. And IDEO.org is kind of specifically a sort of social impact oriented counterpart focused on using design to overcome global poverty and sort of global humanitarian challenges. Since leaving IDEO.org, Liz is the founder and principal of Studio O, a multidisciplinary design consultancy that works at the intersection of racial and spatial justice. Liz is a lecturer at the College of Environmental Design at UC Berkeley, previously has taught at UVA School of Architecture, as faculty at Stanford University's D School, the Hasso-Plattner Institute of Design, as well as held residencies at California College of the Arts, and in Australia as the Droga Architect in Residence. She has been named in Public Interest Design's Top 100 as an Aspen Ideas Scholar, Senior Fellow at the Design Futures Council, to go on and on. I mentioned that Liz had sent sort of all these emails over the years. Invariably, those emails were to share nuggets of information, to put in touch people who should know each other, to respond to emails asking her for information when she was traveling and had literally no time. I mentioned that because, Liz, one of the things that's so inspiring about you and your approach is your willingness to treat everyone with dignity and respect. Your tireless work on behalf of all humanity to lead humbly and through genuine inclusive collaboration, not simply grandstanding. We all know architecture and design can benefit from alternatives to what are by default convention today, but what are the ways we can start to think about expanding our approaches through engagement and design for social transformation? Liz, allow me to, on behalf of all of us, welcome you here again virtually, and we look forward to hearing more from you as you share some ideas and images regarding, as I understand it, I guess you'll tell us more, designing the apocalypse. Thank you so much. You're welcome.
Thank you so much, DK. It's the hardest thing to follow these introductions, especially one like that. But, you know, little did we know all those years ago when we met at the GSD that we would be here today doing this. But I'm delighted to be before you. I'm sorry that it cannot be in person, but COVID. I am glad that we at least get a chance to be in conversation today. And I'm looking forward to sharing a little bit more about my work and what I'm thinking about right now. And hopefully we can have a super generative conversation at the other end of that. Before I share my slides, I just want to offer up a brief land acknowledgement, since I am not in the same location that all of you are at. I just want to honor where I'm coming from. As one of the professors prior to us starting the webinar remarked that the light is a bit different here. I am beaming in from across the country from Huchin, which is the name that the Chechenya-speaking Ohlone people had for this land that is more commonly known today as Oakland. And in invoking their name, I want to give an acknowledgement to the fact that they tended this land for generations before they were displaced from it. And I also want to acknowledge all the other generations of Indigenous, Black, and non-white bodied people who have come here and persevered here and helped shape and made this place what it is, but who have also been oftentimes surrounded by spaces that have seldom acknowledged or celebrated their right to exist. And so that knowledge and holding all that is part of what also inspires me to do what I do. So I just want to give a little shout out to that before we begin. So I'll share my slides and hopefully the technology gods will be in our favor and it will work. I'm going to assume you can all see that. And so the title of this talk is Design in the Apocalypse. And the not so secret joke is that that pretty much has been the title of every talk that I have given since the start of the pandemic. And the content varies from time to time, but really I wanted to hold that as a title just because it really speaks to, I think we're in a state where things are emerging and evolving, and I'll explain a little bit more about the apocalypse framing shortly. But I wanted to hold that none of what I'm about to show you is kind of settled theory or my, you know, five steps to do this and you will figure out design in the apocalypse. It's really just to say that we're in a state of kind of the great unknown. But there are some things that we do know. And so how do we hold the tension within that? And how do we really think about design not as something that we are replicating what has been taught to us for generations, but really asking the questions of what does design need to be in this moment? And how could design perhaps be a leader in thinking through how we can set up different terms and conditions for how we live as a society? And so a lot of the talk today is really going to be taking you through how I've been wrestling with those concepts, both in terms of things out in the broader world and then in my projects in particular. So for me, one of the things that speaks a lot to the things that I think about is this concept of healing, which I recognize is a little bit of a complicated word when we're in the midst of a global pandemic, but it's actually something that's been part of my work for a number of years. And it's been really interesting over the course of the pandemic to see when architects talk about how do we engage the conditions that are happening right now, what that often gets limited to. So, you know, early in the pandemic, when people just needed to be outside in the midst of the lockdown, there were a lot of things about slow streets and reclaiming the public realm and how can long laid plans of creating better streets for people moving through could actually be implemented in kind of these tactical urbanism ways. And then of course, as people started to talk about coming out of lockdown and back together into buildings, architects were sort of seen as the people who would really help us think through ventilation systems and how we could be there together more safely. And while I recognize all of those things as super valid pursuits for us to be looking at, I also want to just challenge them as being very limited pursuits for us to look at. And if that is all that we hold is our purview in these times, then we will be doing a great injustice both to the potential of what we could do and to the need that is actually out there. And so as I think about healing, and particularly not just in the context of the pandemic, but how I've held it more broadly, I really think of this quote that was actually one that I saw early in the pandemic, but I think it really speaks to some of the things that have been framing my work for years. So this was a doctor, and she was sort of just talking about everything that was being laid bare in the midst of the pandemic. And she said that one of the requirements for healing is mourning. And in order to mourn one's pain and suffering, the trauma itself has to be acknowledged. The trauma is not post, it is very current. And the reason why this resonated with me is that if I were to think of the conditions that I find in a lot of the communities that I work in, which are primarily low-income communities of color across the world, what I am dealing with on a day-to-day basis is the presence of unhealed trauma. What you see here is a snapshot of folks that I've worked with over the course of the years. And I would call them, and I do call them my clients. And I know that within how we normally frame architecture, or any of the built environment disciplines really, we think of clients as the people who pay us. I would like to argue that if we are really doing the best that we can do for society and for the built environment, then our definition of client actually needs to expand, and it needs to actually consider anyone who is impacted by our actions. And so for me, this is why these folks are clients, and this is why the work that I do looks at how do I create a meaningful seat for them at the table, and how do I understand what are their challenges and what are their desires. And I would say that wrapped up in both of those things is the challenge of trauma and the desire to be free from it and live the life that is not about survival, but about thriving. And so if I am really doing right by these folks, then part of my work needs to be looking at what does that mean? For a number of years, the tool that I have seen to support this is actually fighting to achieve spatial justice. So for those of you who are not familiar with the term, spatial justice was actually coined by geographers a number of decades ago. And it effectively means that justice has a geography and that the equitable distribution of access, resources, opportunities, and outcomes should be a basic human right. And the reality is that we don't have spatial justice in countless communities across this country and around the world when there are differences in which neighborhoods wind up with all the industrial uses and which neighborhoods get the gleaming office towers, or which neighborhoods wind up with the insufficient bus routes and which ones get the multi-million dollar transit centers, or even which neighborhoods see a plethora of vacant lots and which ones get a lot of the nice parks. And the reality is that oftentimes we don't see this injustice in space in random places. It often overlays with race and class. Indigenous, Black, Brown, and poor communities disproportionately wind up in areas where there is an intense lack of spatial justice. And so that's part of why I say that my work operates at the intersection of spatial and racial justice, because I don't actually think we can achieve racial or social justice as long as we continue to be separated and selectively harmed by space. Space has to be part of the conversation. And I think for too long, we as architects and designers, planners, landscape architects, et cetera, have not really grabbed onto that mandate as much as we should have. And so I think the things that we're seeing in particular right now in the midst of the pandemic, really in some ways, they're screaming more loudly than ever before, so that those who have not stopped to listen and speak to this before now, hopefully your attention has been grabbed. And so I really look at how do I hold these things in the context of my work? And then once again, really thinking about this idea of how do we introduce trauma and healing into this discourse? And so that kind of brings me to this sense of the apocalypse. So I use it not in the like kind of tongue-in-cheek of like, oh my God, sci-fi apocalypse, but more in reference to its original definition in ancient Greek, which meant an uncovering or unveiling, a reveal. And so I definitely feel that in this time, we've seen some sort of revelation. And again, it's not necessarily that things are new, but I do think that we've hit a point where people are paying a bit more attention. And so about a year and a half ago, I was asked to write an essay to talk about cultural leadership. And you know, at this time, it was the summer of 2020, and I was just sitting kind of struck by the images that were coming to my social media and TV screens, the stories of Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, and countless others who had been senselessly murdered, or the fact that when we talk about essential workers who were making it possible for some of us to live better lives in the pandemic, that they were notably often coming from Black and Brown communities. Or looking at the fact that there was the high death toll of COVID in those same communities. And so when you think about how do we possibly hold all of this stuff and what does it mean for us as designers or architects working in that, I couldn't help but hold that none of the things that I was seeing at that time that any of us were seeing were actually new. And I really love this quote from the Buddhist leader, Reverend Angel Kyoto Williams, that talks about the fact that the virus might not know boundaries or borders, but it already knows how to follow the systems of injustice that are already in place. And so the idea that we had millions of people who were contending with food and housing insecurity, and that they were disproportionately people of color, were looking at who happened to have the highest rates of death and bad health outcomes, or who did we need to march in the street for. Again, this idea that we had sort of been here before was something that I was really struck with. And thinking about my work, I really wanted to understand, well, what are the implications for that? That we had suddenly reached a time where the world got quiet enough for many more people to listen, to see, and to feel. And what does that mean for how we talk about the things that we need to do from here on out? And so for me, one of the things that popped out is this idea that we often feel and seem like we are trapped in this loop of injustice and harm, where we oscillate between these states of emergency and complacency. And by urgency, you know, there's that often repeated quote of the fierce urgency of now. And I don't mean to say that any of the issues that we're facing aren't urgent, but I think that often the way in which we approach them is really around this idea of the urgency to forget that we are uncomfortable, to forget that we're seeing people senselessly die, to forget that who is dying isn't fair, that we need to do enough to get back to normal, to return to how things were before. And effectively, that's getting to a state of complacency in which we are completely set up with this idea that we don't have to remember that there is an unequal system of justice, that there is an unequal distribution in who has access, who has resources, and who has positive outcomes. And that collateral harm is effectively inevitable. And so one of the things that I think about is neither of those situations seem to sit right with me, and I hope that they don't sit right with you. And so what would it take for us to actually think about how do we not just look at our work as being good enough, patching a few holes here and there, but really leveraging our work to break these loops of injustice and actually create better opportunities and outcomes for all. And really questioning what is the role of those who are involved in shaping the built environment in negotiating all of that and supporting all of that. And so in returning to this idea of healing, like I said, it's something that I've been thinking about for many years, but I feel like the new, you know, if you will, sense of urgency that I'm feeling in the pandemic is that the healing can't just be limited at the level of stopping, building housing to stop a brief amount of pain, but really, like, how are we thinking more systemically at breaking the loop of injustice so that we don't ever arrive at this point again? Part of that, I think, actually requires us taking responsibility for what it means to be a shaper of the built environment, and also acknowledging that architecture, planning, and similar professions have actually been involved in, and I would say almost complicit, in supporting conditions of harm, right? So if we think about redlining, which happened in the earlier part of the 20th century, and I would argue still in some ways goes on now, or looking at urban renewal, which, you know, conveniently seemed to always hit Black and brown neighborhoods, or looking at things like public housing. And while it's easy to think of these things as stuff that happened decades ago and are not part of our world now, the truth of the matter is if you go to any community that was impacted by this, you actually see the physical remnants of it. And what was so insidious about a lot of these moves is in many ways, as if you think particularly of when civil rights laws and legal opinions were being made, that was a time where you saw a resurgence of these physical policies and interventions, which in some ways codified in ways that you're condemning generations to deal with stuff that legally was being removed from the books. And so it's not past at all. It is very much present, very similar to that quote about trauma. And so as we think about what it means to address these conditions, I think we have to contend that the built environment has been part of the participant in setting up conditions of harm. And so for me, that's part of why we need to be at the table to talk about what healing looks like. But it also is a mandate that I think just building better housing or just building a park here and there almost isn't enough, that we have to wholesale change the way in which we're approaching the work, and also look at how are we meaningfully addressing some of these conditions that still remain within our physical environment. So what I wanted to do for the remainder of the time is just show you a couple of projects that I've been working on over the last couple of years, talk to you about how that engages this concept of healing and also disrupting some of these conditions that I think the built environment has been, and you know, the professions engaged with the built environment have been complicit in creating, and hopefully set us up for like a really interesting conversation on the other side of that. So the first project I wanted to show is close to me here in the Bay Area. It's located in the city of East Palo Alto, California, which is about 45 minutes south of here. And if you're not familiar with East Palo Alto, it was covered in several case studies in Richard Rothstein's great book, The Color of Law. And it effectively is like an oasis of poverty in Silicon Valley. Facebook or Meta, whatever they're calling themselves now, is located on the edge of the city. And if you're a cleaner at Facebook, this is probably one of the few places that you can afford to live in anywhere close to your work. And it is also very much a product of things like redlining and urban renewal. So back in the 60s, Black people in particular were locked out of being able to move into, or either through things like blockbusting or getting mortgages, most of the other cities surrounding East Palo Alto. And so East Palo Alto kind of became this home to the Black population in the South Bay for many, many decades. And then now it's kind of transitioned to a majority Latino neighborhood. This project that I'm working in is a naturally occurring affordable housing project that is located on one portion of the town, 1,800 units that had been successively through multiple slumlords brought into one big development. And so my client is actually the current owner who took over with in part a mandate to try and figure out how to improve the quality of life for the residents living in these units. And that's where I was brought in. One of the things that we did first was to actually hold a series of listening parties or listening sessions. And I should say that I am sort of notorious amongst my clients in that I often refuse to hold community meetings at the start of projects. And that's largely because I think everyone from the built environment practitioners to the traditional clients to the resident clients, everybody has a kind of a way in which we know what community meetings are about, right? That they're a place that you come, there's a lot of yelling. It's like the few occasions that you will have to actually speak to what you want to see, but it's always, it feels like a bit of a hamstrung process. And I will often, when I do workshops with architects, ask how many have been to a good community meeting. And not surprisingly, I don't see that many people raising their hands. And so for me, I feel a lot of times that everyone's understanding of a community meeting is that it is a super transactional process. And I really believe that if we're really to disrupt the way in which built environment work has been done in the past, we really need to set up relationships and relationships of trust. Because anytime that you're coming in and actually trying to change someone's environment, that is incredibly triggering. Imagine if somebody came and said, we're gonna do stuff to your home, and you don't really have much of a say of it. You can speak up, but you don't know if what you say is going to be listened to. That sets up an environment of mistrust. And so in these communities in particular, who have been harmed repeatedly over decades and over generations, it's really important to start projects with things that can allow you to build relationships of trust. And so that's what we attempted to do here. And I will say, in a number of these sessions, I got yelled at a lot, as did my colleagues. And what we found is that in many ways, it was because people were so used to no one listening to them that shouting was almost a way to make sure your voice got heard. There's a great poet named Nayir Wahid that says, has this poem that says that anger is grief that has been silent for too long. And so I think in many ways what we heard in those yells was just a lot of grief of having to live with these conditions that were not really fair at all. I mean, there were certain things that we heard that the ownership wasn't even aware of, like crime had been a pretty significant issue in this community. At one point in the 90s, East Palo Alto was considered the murder capital of the US. But the security company that like my paying client had didn't have anyone on the ground who spoke Spanish. This in a heavily Latino neighborhood, but there hadn't been an effective way to communicate that. These listening sessions ended up being a way to do that. And one of the things that I do a lot in my work is as soon as we learn things in a listening session, the idea is to figure out how do we make sure that we can show that we heard and respond to it. And so in the case of the security company, we ended up, the property owner ended up letting go of that old company and then bringing on one that had a track record of both Spanish speakers and good relationships with in the communities that they were serving. What you see on this slide is a park that actually was the product of some of those early listening sessions. And it was something that came out not initially or that we even thought to ask about, but it really took getting through those first really tense conversations where people felt like they had been able to get off some of the pain from their chest, that they then started to reveal what were some of the pain points for them. Because this is a community filled with a lot of low wage workers who were often working second shifts, third shifts, there weren't a lot of places for them to recreate. There is an issue of overcrowding in this area of town. They're also not, because of bad planning, there's not a lot of sidewalks in this part of town. So they also were seeing a situation where they might not have been home a lot. There were a lot of kids. The kids were playing in the streets, which was sort of a dangerous condition. And there are no parks on the side of town, I should also say. So we were able to work with the property owner to identify an empty lot. And then we did a co-design process with the community to create this pop-up park. And what was really cool is that, it kind of became an instant hit. And one of the things that I do with a lot of my work is I don't leave it at just this idea of as soon as we build the space, then we are complete. I really try to listen and make sure I'm fully understanding what are the core needs. And so it wasn't only just to have a place to play and to be able to relax outside. People also often said that they wanted to be healthy. They wanted to be more fit. And, we could have easily just put in some exercise equipment, but I also find it's important to ask questions such as, well, why aren't you fit now? What is keeping you from doing that? And as we did that exploration, we found that people didn't know how, and they wanted and needed support. So we worked with the property owner to build the partnership with the local YMCA, which was located on the other side of the town. And so the property owner provided subsidized membership for all residents, but also we were able to get the YMCA to come and do classes in our parks so that people who already were time poor did not have to go all the way across town. They could just come to the park and do yoga and Zumba. And what's super awesome is that what you see here is a park that is located on the other side of the property. So 1800 units, it's pretty spread out. And so a lot of the first park that I showed you was on the north side. And so residents from the south side were coming to use some of the programming, but they were like, we want something on our side of the town too. And so they wrote a letter to the property owner to petition for a second park to be built. And this is one that we created out of another empty space that was on that side of town. And one of the things that I think is really great about this is the fact that through some of the work that we had been doing, that was sort of what nudged things in the direction that folks were willing to kind of write a letter and petition and fight for this space, which for me is part of the goal of the work, right? It's not just creating the physical space, but if somehow through what we're doing, we can actually create conditions of participatory power and create better relationships between these two sets of clients, then that's part of what the success story is. And so for me, that is actually even more of a win than the fact that we have the space now. This effort and beginning this conversation that would then result in changes in space actually set things up pretty nicely. For a couple of years into our work, we ended up identifying a portion of the property that was suitable for redevelopment. Most of the buildings that are these 1800 units are in are 50 to 100 years old. So they're actually reaching the end of their life. And so we were able to find a small parcel, it's probably about 4% of the overall property, to redevelop. And we basically scaled up the same co-design process that we had when we did the pop-up parks. And we even used some of the information that we had gotten during that process of developing the pop-up parks to use that as the sort of ground setting rules for how we were going to do this redevelopment. And I think it's really important that, you know, in many ways, it was like that was a prototype. And so we had sort of set up how we do conversations and how that shapes space. And that was important both for the property owner and for the residents to see, so that when we got to this process, unlike traditional processes that often happen in this town around working with large scale property owners or developers, this one has actually been a pretty great process. And we've even had residents going to city council to speak on behalf of the developer for this project because they see themselves and they see their words reflected in what's happening. The second project that I wanted to talk about is also a local project to me, located in San Francisco, just across the bay in a neighborhood called Bayview Hunters Point, which is in the southeastern quadrant of the city. It is a historic working class neighborhood that has always been home to migrants and immigrants in San Francisco. And then starting around World War II, it in particular became the hub of the African-American community in San Francisco. But it is also a great example of what the lack of spatial justice looks like. So it was home and continues to be for many of the city's industrial uses, like the power plant that you see. One of the largest sewage treatment plants near a residential neighborhood in this country is in this neighborhood. It also had the highest amount of public housing in the city. And you know, just as an indication of you know, how that all then you know, pans out, pre-pandemic, the median home price in San Francisco was a little over $1.5 million. In Bayview Hunters Point, the median household income was just a little bit over $63,000. So you can see that like in this neighborhood, there's a lot of lack, but there's also some pretty amazing community action and fighting around that. And so this power plant is actually a great example of that. Back in the late 1990s, a group of mothers who were living in the public housing on the hill, this hill above the plant, led a community coalition to fight for this plant's closure. They were successful, and in the mid-2000s, PG&E, who's the owner, finally tore this down and capped it with asphalt so that the clean soil wouldn't blow away. But in doing that, they were wound up with 30 acres. And 30 acres of asphalt, which you know, you can imagine is a huge piece of land to have vacant for what was likely going to be about 10 years. And actually now we're probably looking more at 20 years. And so they reached out to design firms to propose some interim uses. And I'm part of a team along with Envelope A plus D and RHAA that won that commission. And for the past 8 years, we've worked with those residents and the utility company and local organizations to program the site with uses that could actually serve as a community benefit. And that's everything from job training workshops to an annual circus, to even in the time of COVID, when we were basically asking, how can we use the resources that we have access to be in service to the community, because COVID rules did not allow us to continue programming like this. And what we heard from a lot of our partners is that there was a huge food insecurity issues. So we leveraged our partnerships and were able to turn the site into a food giveaway site and gave away thousands of bags of food for many months. Over the course of the 8 years that we had been operational, over 30,000 people had come to the site, and it had grown to become a pretty beloved site within the community. Now, As an architect, it'd be really easy to rest my laurels on like, look, we created this really cool thing and this is all that you get to see. But I think the really important thing to hold with these projects is it's not just about the like beautiful pictures of kids and that's how we mark success. for us, the thing that has actually felt most successful about this project is using it as an opportunity to have an ongoing conversation about some of the grief associated with the past and how that ties into desires of the future. Some of those desires manifest in the programming that you see, but some of it is in just having a place for their story to be told. And so that means that I will share pictures like this, which is a park that was built on the edge of the site as part of this project. And the thing that is important about this image isn't so much this beautiful thing, although that is important, but it's actually these interpretive signage, which were ways in which we made sure that some of those stories that were told got permanently etched into the landscape. And we've continued, also with programming to make sure that there were these opportunities for these stories to be told, and using that both to understand what existed here, what people needed to grieve and reckon with, and what we needed to sort of plant a flag in as we think about how do we move towards the future. And so that consisted of things like an early partnership with StoryCorps. The very first thing that we did on the site was to actually build a listening booth. And we invited folks who had been involved in the fight to tear down the plant to come and record their stories. To more recently, just before the pandemic, we concluded a year-long partnership with the artist Chris Johnson, who was one of the creators of the Question Bridge Black Male exhibit. And we brought Question Bridge to Bayview, and in particular set up a year-long conversation asking questions about race, identity, and space, and brought residents and participants into our program to have that conversation. And again, not with an idea of resolving it, but sort of saying this space is here. Like, we actually have to talk about it in order to move towards a solution. And then what you see on the right is we did a full-scale exhibit of the Question Bridge Black Males project, which is in a number of museum collections around the world, and actually includes some residents from the Bayview, but had never been shown in this neighborhood. And so all of that is like, how can we use design to actually create these incubators and these containers for important conversations that need to be held? Right now, where we are with this project is that PG&E has closed out the particular portion of the project that we've been involved with, and is trying to figure out what happens next. And I think it's actually allowed a really interesting conversation for my team and I to sort of say, if we're really treating the relationship that we've built over the past 8 years as a relationship, what does it mean to say an intentional goodbye and set the community up to continue to have agency in determining what happens next? And so we just won a pretty big grant with the Kristen Damro Dance Company to collaborate and create a performance that will be based on stories from the community as a way to kind of say goodbye to the site and give the community information and a conversation that sets them up for agency and what's next. The final project that I'll show is a little bit closer to all of you. It's located in Charlottesville, Virginia, Friendship Court. It's a project that I've been on since late 2015. You can see there's a theme that I'm often involved in work for a number of years. It is a 150 Section 8 affordable housing project. And the mandate was really it had never had a major redevelopment in the 40 years that it had been in existence. And the goal was to do zero displacement. And so the paid client, Piedmont Housing Alliance, it's a nonprofit, wanted to figure out how to do that in a way that really let the residents lead the conversation of what they wanted to see. Now, when you hear of Charlottesville, you likely think of the white supremacist incursion that happened in 2017 and resulted in a lot of harm, including the death of Heather Heyer. And I wanna sort of note that that is very much in the vicinity of this project. So this is 4th Street where Heather was killed. And if you were to go down just 2 blocks, you would get to Friendship Court. We had been doing our work before those events of 2017, but you know, we could not ignore the proximity to it. But in reality, the legacy of racial harm long predated this. We could go back to slavery. Charlottesville as a city was actually came into being as a result of some former plantations. And UVA, the University of Virginia, which is just down the road, some residents for quite some time still refer to it as the plantation. But you could also go more recently into the 1960s when urban renewal came to a city as small as Charlottesville and destroyed Vinegar Hill, which was one of the most vibrant Black neighborhoods in Charlottesville, and created concentrated super blocks of racialized poverty like Friendship Court. And so as we thought about what we needed to do, I often repeat something that Sunshine Mathone, the executive director of Piedmont Housing Alliance, has said to me, that if all we do is build housing, we're just helping the poor to be poorer better. So our charge was, how do we look at not just creating a plan that had all the right bits and pieces that would represent a model affordable housing project, but how do we expand it to really look beyond to see what the residents needed to potentially lift them out of poverty? That if we're not leveraging the development to accomplish these aims, then we're just repeating the same harms that have existed before. And so what you see here are some spatial justice pillars and programming that was derived from the residents. We've been working with an advisory committee that's made up primarily of residents. Over the last 6 years, we've effectively trained them to be co-decision makers in the process. So there isn't a major decision that happens that is not first made by them. And so really, instead of looking at the end destination of what we're trying to accomplish being the affordable housing project, we're really looking at what we're trying to accomplish is better outcomes that actually connect to thrivance for the residents. And so therefore, it means every decision that we make is a resident-centered decision. And it means beyond looking at housing, we're looking at things like generational wealth, shared power, cultural belonging and empathy, healing and well-being, and actually challenging the project to figure out how does it create both spaces and programs that enable these things to start to happen. And so this is just kind of a zooming in of seeing some of the things that resulted from just the cultural belonging and empathy. And all of these were derived by that resident advisory committee. And I describe this as looking at the idea of how do we do place-based reparations and place-based repair. I know we often think of reparations as kind of cash-based transactions, and that is not to say that we should not be paying people, but it's also to say that, if you go back to some of those images that I showed a little while ago, that if we're not also talking about how the place itself begins to participate in repair, then we're only covering half of the issue that needs to be resolved. So coming back to this lens of healing, I'm not presenting any of this as like, these are definitively what we need to do to solve for this healing factor. It's almost a process of inquiry and exploration. And I was just talking to a resident on one of my projects the other day, and I was repeating to her this James Baldwin quote that says, not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it's faced. And so for me, moving into healing isn't sort of saying, I know exactly what to do to heal. It's more sort of saying, I am accepting the challenge that I need to be a participant in healing. And I hope through seeing some of these projects that you can accept that challenge as well. If I were to give you a little bit more of a how, I think I would just say, I think the very first thing we need to think about starting is how are we building better relationships with the people who our work is meant to serve? I said this quote probably two, three years ago, and somebody helpfully captured it. But it really speaks to me of what I enter a lot of my projects with, that I'm in a sacred relationship with the people who are impacted by my actions. That is my responsibility as the caretaker for the built environment. And so if I were to challenge you to do anything, to start, it would be this, like, how do you think about these relationships that you are forming with the people who will be impacted by what you have the power to do? And so I'll just leave you with these three prompts that for me are what are coming up as how I start in that. How are we holding space to acknowledge that harm has been done here? Are we reckoning with who has been harmed and how? And also with who benefited and how? I think sometimes we have a tendency to want to focus on the quote unquote victim without also focusing on not necessarily the perpetrators, although that is important, but also the beneficiaries, because it is a complete system here. And unless we contend with both, it actually becomes really hard to move the needle. And then finally, are we letting the terms and conditions of repair and healing be determined by those most harmed in the past? And that really speaks again to this idea of elevating those who are most impacted by what has been done and what will be done as the clients as well. And finally, I'll just leave you with this quote, which Arundhati Roy wrote this beautiful essay called The Pandemic is a Portal in the summer 2020. If you have not read it, go read it. It's in Fortune. But in it, she said nothing could be worse than a return to normal. And you know, going back to what I said in the beginning and thinking about the apocalypse and thinking about this idea that we seem trapped in this loop of injustice and harm, if coming out of COVID and the global pandemic, and I should say coming out in scare quotes, then if we go back to the way in which we practiced before, the way in which we treated residents of these communities before, then I see that as just as bad as everything that we've suffered through in the last 3 years. And so I wanna challenge you to how do you hold this as a mantra as well, that nothing could be worse than a return to normal. So with that, I thank you for listening. And I think we have time for some questions. So I'm looking forward to having a discussion.
Thank you so much for that, Liz. Really a lot of different sort of ideas to process and kind of internalize and meditate on. Maybe I will sort of, I have a million questions here, so I'm doing like a whole bunch of kind of filtering and tabulation here. But I feel like several of these questions relate to, can be kind of grouped into a number of sort of thematics. So I might sort of introduce one first kind of idea to let you perhaps expand on it a little bit more.
Sure.
And it has to do with something that you shared, I think maybe a little bit towards the beginning of the talk about, I'm even looking to see if I can see it in my notes. I can't find it right now, but I remember it, which was this idea that you're trying to challenge how we might think about who constitutes client. And you showed some images of some sort of, I don't know, this having not being as close to these people, I'll say members of a community, and saying that I consider these folks as my clients alongside who other folks who might also be clients. And I think another point in time you made a comment about something like almost like managing different sets of clients or something like that. And I want you to maybe elaborate on that a little bit more for the simple reason that oftentimes the reason why certain people may feel empowered as a client in the context of design services is because they're paying. And therein lies a kind of inherent sort of unequal or sort of inequalities or inequity sometimes within these systems, because at the end of the day, someone is signing checks and therefore has a particular level of power and influence over any kind of outcomes in the built environment. So the question in a way is, how do you kind of negotiate this partly from the perspective of, to put it bluntly, who may pay you versus people who you have some type of responsibility toward, whether or not they may be paying you in the same way. So essentially it's like, how do you negotiate that?
Yeah, so thank you for that question. I think it's an important one to talk about. And I would say, you know, I think the first thing that we should hold bar none is, anytime we're receiving payment to be able to make some decisions that impact somebody's environment, that is power. And so I think sometimes when I talk to architects and other built environment practitioners about this, they're like, but I have no power in this system, right? And so I think it's really important to hold that we actually do have some power. Our clients are coming, and I'm sticking with the traditional framing of client right now. Our clients are coming to us with an expectation that we have some form of expertise, that that expertise will be used to sort of say how a project process should go, what are the steps of it, who needs to be talked to as part of that. And I think oftentimes we default to what has already been done before, right? Like it almost becomes autopilot without ever challenging that. But there's actually a tremendous amount of power in them looking to you as an expert. And so it's like, how do you really leverage that signifier as expert in this situation? The other thing I would say, you know, particularly for me, if someone's coming to me, like I'm very clear on my kind of red lines. And so people know that I have a very strong principled approach to how I do the work. And so I will not do a project if there is not a clear and equitable way in which community members are involved in the project. I do not do the rubber stamp engagement process, and I will walk away from projects and have that speak to that. So I think also being willing to risk that, right? Like not say, well, the most important thing is just for me to get it done regardless of what happens, but to say, no, I will actually risk getting paid. I will risk my livelihood for an ethical stance. And because of that, I actually think I get more respect from the clients because they know that as a condition. And then the last thing I'll say is that I think it's really important not to paint the sort of paying client in the sort of boogeyman position. They want to succeed. And if I am working at my most compassionate self, I have to trust that everybody is doing the best that they can and that they're making decisions and directing some things because they think it's the best way to get it done. And they have not been shown that there's another way and they don't know how to take risk to leap into that other way. And so I see part of my role as supporting that risk taking. And so the kind of generosity and care that I give to a community member is the same one that I actually give to the paying client. So it's really important to me to understand what do they need to get out of this for it to be successful? Because part of what I might need to do is just a translation to help them understand how creating more space for community members in the process actually supports their aims. So if you take PG&E, they will say in a heartbeat that they are not a community developer. They don't do community engagement. And so when we pitch some of the stuff, I mean, I in particular remember when we tried to pitch the circus the first time around, they were like looking at us like we were batshit crazy. And what we had to say was like, your aim is to have a good reputation within this community and to see the site stewarded and that like site management is what the internal team needed to show to their bosses, successful site management. There was a very traditional way in which site management was done, which was about security companies, fences, et cetera. We needed to show that we could do that in a different way and get them additional benefit off of that. And so we didn't come in saying this is a community development strategy. We said, this is a site management strategy. This is how you meet the things you want to meet. And I think, you know, I've had other situations where traditional clients are used to a very antagonistic relationship with the community and being able to have a conversation where they see themselves seen as a person and not part of an entity because part of what I've been doing is brokering this relationship. That gives them confidence that like, oh, what you're saying isn't wrong. I actually see things we're getting here that we never would have been able to accomplish if we had done it the way that I traditionally do it.
Thank you, it's super helpful. I think Marcus, you wanna go ahead, right?
Yeah, if BK, if you don't mind it, I'd like to just ask attach a question. Liz, thank you so much for showing your work and for giving everybody a perspective into what you're doing and where you're working. I know that there are people in our audience who will be looking at this and asking a lot of questions. In anticipation of that, you know, having gone to architecture school myself, I'm wondering where you got all of the other education that allows you to be able to do this work. And as someone who is approached by students often saying, I'm really interested in working for underserved communities, I'm interested in working in disaster relief or working for people who've been displaced, where do students on a Research One campus go? What other resources can students who are in a BArc program or an MArc program, where would you send them if you were on a Research One campus to get this other stuff that I know you have?
Yeah, so I mean, for start, I would say I often joke that I was the weird kid in my family who drew. So like I'm the product of social scientists, and I definitely feel that that influence really shaped how I looked at the world. But that then in turn manifested in what I did when I got to college. I mean, I went to a liberal arts college, not a Research One campus, but, and I was really fortunate that the architecture degree there actually wasn't a department. So you could sort of pick and choose what you wanted to count towards a major. You could do a bunch of studios at MIT, which I did do, but you could also petition for things that weren't on the official list. And so for having grown up with social scientists, I felt like I need to understand the people who are living in these environments so I know what to build. So I took classes in anthropology, sociology, urban economics, et cetera. And that really, you know, shaped my thinking. And when I teach, I introduce texts in those disciplines. So I think if you have access to that at your university, I know sometimes the architecture program doesn't always allow the flexibility to take the courses you want to take. But I mean, at any level that you can seek that out, I would. And even if not a class, then lectures, right? Like one of the amazing gifts of the pandemic is like a ton of stuff has come online, which I know you're probably sick of staring at Zoom, but it's a great way to learn about things that you wouldn't otherwise be able to learn. And I would say for me, the learning still hasn't stopped. So in this last year, I took an embodied social justice certificate program. I took a course looking that was taught by a Buddhist teacher about how to hold a seven generation framework and how we look at social justice. I took another embodiment course that was focused on particular embodiment with the racial justice lens. I'm looking right now at taking a trauma course. So you can still continue to learn. That teaching is out there, whether it's through lectures, through courses, or through long courses or webinars, or even just books. I mean, I can't say that I've read every single thing that's on my shelf, but I've read a lot of it, and a lot of it crosses a bunch of different disciplines. And so just continue to be a seeker of knowledge. And then the last thing I will say is, I think the best teachers for me in being able to see these varied conditions that I talk about in the context of my work are community members themselves. And so whenever I go into a community, even like the, you know, now almost 15 years of experience that I have, I am basically like, I need to learn. I don't know shit. I have some stuff I can bring as examples, but like, I don't know what it means to live in this community. You are the expert in that. And I am humbly asking if you will help me learn about this community. And that actually goes along, I mean, the sort of joke on a lot of my projects is like, I'm the most trusted member across the entire team, because I always go in with this, like, I'm here to learn and listen. And before anything comes out of my mouth, I'm like opening up my ears to just listen to the stories that you have to share. And then I reflect it back to you so that you know that I heard.
So much. I think someone has tacked a question onto my question. So if you don't mind, I'll read you their question. Coming out of our audience from Niles Parker. Do you see a shift in the effectiveness of these human-based methods when you scale up or scale down the number of clients you work with?
Yeah, that's a great question. So it's always a delicate balance figuring out how many projects I take on, and I am a very, you know, small shop. So it's not like there's definitely more demand than there is of me. But one of the core pieces of the work that I do is I want to make sure that the sum total of the particular practice doesn't just rest with me. It's really, at some point, even though I often end up being on projects for years, at some point I do leave, like my term ends with a project. And if nobody else on the sort of client team or community team knows how to do this process or carry this work on, then that's a failure for me. So a lot of what I do is I try to bring in folks who are either working with a traditional client or who are community members or some combination of both, who are kind of getting trained up on these processes so that even if I'm not necessarily exhaustively on the ground, which I haven't necessarily been able to be because of COVID, that work is still happening, that people are still putting these practices into play. So that's how I do it. But like, definitely it leads me to say no a lot, because I recognize that there's a capacity limit for me. I also have to have a recovery limit, being somebody who holds so much of the emotional wounding on a team. Like, that is also personally something I have to make sure that I'm taking care of myself. I would also say, you know, one of the things prior to the pandemic, I significantly reduced the amount of international work that I was doing, in part because I recognized that it was hard to stretch to that and all the stuff that I was doing domestically, and that I needed to kind of choose a lane for at least a little bit that I was going to focus on. So I am constantly making decisions with respect to what is my capacity in every given moment, and am I providing the level of service that I feel comfortable with? And sometimes that even means, you know, I have a couple projects that have approached me now, and I'm working on a couple things, so I don't necessarily have the capacity to be on the ground in the same way that I was in some of the projects that I showed to you. And instead, I've been saying, but I will serve as an advisor. I will totally be this person that you could have strategic conversations with as you think through processes. And so, you know, there's a couple projects on the books right now where I'm basically doing just that.
If I may actually sort of piggyback onto that one, actually, Liz, and I'm super happy that Niles asked this question, because the MR cohort has kind of just gone through a kind of super crash course, micro intro to HCD, like human-centered design methods as a kind of general approach, which, I mean, this is partly why this talk is so exciting for us to see right now, is in a way, I don't want to say upending, maybe that's too dramatic, but let's say it's complexifying some of the more conventional ways in which we conduct certain kinds of architectural projects. And one of the conversations that we've had sort of just, I guess I can say here, because you're now here virtually with us, is in a way how these approaches operate in parallel and how they can kind of communicate one from the other. And so when I say sort of these in parallel, I'm sort of saying that on one hand, you have some type of program-driven approach to architectural delivery, which is somehow top-down, and this goes back to the notion of client, versus something from a human-centered design world that is at least giving lip service to some nominal idea of design thinking being an approach of, as you would say, being on the ground and actually engaging with end users and trying to identify what their needs are and then centering those needs really at the heart of any kind of sort of design prompt as well as process. So if those are kind of parallel approaches, the question, and not to come across as the mechanic, but I'm very interested in the mechanics of this, is how do you capture the kind of insights that you surfaced through your engagement with these communities, through these listening parties, all of these ways in which you actually dialogue with you know, all these different, as you would say, clients? How do you capture that information and present it in essence as a, if I can say, quote unquote, deliverable, so that other folks at the table will see it as equally valid alongside some series of drawings or some series of sort of data-driven metrics that are in a chart format? How do you package this in a way so that this is taken seriously by everyone who needs to participate in the conversation?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So, you know, two things I'll just say straight off is, one of my favorite quotes is from Brené Brown, who says that stories are data with a soul. So I sort of see part of the essence of what we need to do is make sure that the stories can be read as data, right? So that is a driver for how I look at what is the imperative around how I think about sharing this stuff. And then the other thing that I'll say is that my time at IDEO.org was super useful because, you know, thinking about practices like IDEO.org and IDEO.com, one of the things that they've been really great at is getting clients to think about investing heavily in design thinking. And one of the ways in which they've done that is that they create reports. They will look a lot of different ways, but the reports capture the essence of that story data in ways that can be translated to what the client needs to understand. So what I've done on projects, so like Friendship Court, when we first started, didn't do the community meetings, or we did that loosely, but I did a lot of interviews in home for a number of residents, right? And I was probably the first person who had done that in a long time, if at all. And I brought in somebody from the nonprofit with me. We had tons of data. When I shared back with the rest of the team, I shared it both in the form of quotes. So you have the real life words of somebody, which actually is, you know, I think there's a way that some people think that that feels like really hokey or not like real data. But if you think about the things that you react to, you probably feel closer to stories than a dry like narrative that is describing a particular condition on the ground. A quote from somebody of saying, you know, I was never expecting to be here this long. I feel stuck. That matters a lot more than me saying, well, so the social and economic mobility of this place is pretty constrained, right? So I make sure to bring both the images and the words of people in front of these other folks. And then, you know, in that project, one of the things that I did is I created a diagram that maps the entire property and mapped what were the problem points based on quotes that people had said. And so a normal site analysis that you would do is us looking at physical things and saying, oh, that fence is broken. There's an opening over here. Here I was able to say, this is an incredible conflict zone because it is a pinch point where all of these things are coming together. And I had quotes from residents explaining how it works as a, you know, pinch point, right? So there were things that wouldn't, or even the security company thing, right? Like, that's a thing that you wouldn't know, but is actually super important to the running of the property and why people would trust ownership or not. So presenting reports that bring in this information, and I also give my analysis up against those quotes and words. So it's not just that I'm putting that out. I'm sort of saying me as an expert, taking my interpretation of this, this is what my takeaway of all of this is. And these are my recommendations. And so the pairing of images of people, images of the whatever the thing is, if it's a site or a program or diagrams, what have you, and my analysis, together, that actually offers up a pretty compelling story. And where possible, I will weave in actual like kind of, you know, quantitative data points, right? But basically, I see my role as part storyteller. And I've got to help take these stories that might not have been registered to the level of visibility before and use my creative skills to make it visible and make it feel compelling. If you're an architect and you've gone through a studio course where you somehow have to convince a jury to buy this premise, you know what it is like to take various streams of data and drawings and construct a story. It is effectively the same thing. It's just the points that I'm using are perhaps slightly different than what we are traditionally taught in architectural school to use.
Do you ever find a need to somehow decouple your kind of needs assessment? Because again, not to completely harp on this, but you know, if you develop kind of sort of assessment or map of needs that speak to, let's say, a community of residents in a particular sort of residential community, and you're somehow looking at some of these needs in order to translate these, the way you mentioned is very interesting, in a way that's almost like ready to be digested. It's almost like you prepackage it as an input back into the rest of the whole design process so that everybody else can use it. And if it's not sort of packaged in that way, it might be harder for people to sort of take it in. But in doing that, it seems like you're also kind of in a way having to develop some type of model of what the other needs are beyond the needs of the residents themselves. So back to this idea of kind of multiple clients, if you really consider them all as sort of stakeholders and participants in the project, they may all have real needs because they're real people, but their needs may be divergent. And so do you somehow bracket when you're talking to residents, for example, and say, look, these are some of the needs of the, like, let's, I don't know, management company or a developer, let's take those into consideration. And then when you go back, do you then say, like, how do you sort of negotiate that in terms of bundling them all together versus bracketing them and sort of disaggregating this sort of larger map of needs?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, you know, the same process that I described of like sitting and interviewing residents individually or in the group, I do that exact same process with the traditional client so that I'm super clear on from the get what their needs are and what might be also their desires for success. And just like my conversations with residents is ongoing throughout the entire process of a project, it's the same thing with the traditional client. And so I may take something from the community and present it to that other client. And if I'm getting pushback, then my thing is not to sort of say, oh, it's okay, it's gotta be either or. It's to try to interrogate what is the pushback about, right? Where are we running into challenges and see if, and this is where like what I'm bringing to the table, if we can find a middle ground. If that is not possible and it has to be something around choice, then what I try to do is broaden who the decision makers are around choice, right? So with, say Friendship Court, we're now in this thing where it's a multi-phase project and we're having this conversation about amenities that are coming across the different phases and who's gonna get access to what. There are some very clear constraints that have to do with like building code, budgets, et cetera, right? Meeting up against what the desires of the residents are. And so rather than saying, well, there's just this limited thing that we can do, we're going to the residents and we're going to have a meeting and sort of say, this is what we've heard you articulate as desires. Here is some of the challenges that we're facing. Here are a couple of the decision points that we can see. Here are the trade-offs on each. What do you think? And we support them as much as possible to be able to have all the information that they feel they need to be able to make a decision. And so I think it's not to sort of short circuit anybody's ability to decide or run away from complicated decisions. It's just to ask, how do we give people the most amount of information that they can take to be able to make an informed decision? And I'm also like super transparent with people about what they have the power to decide and what they don't. I don't think everybody expects that they have to make a decision about everything, right? Like I think actually a lot of residents expect there are some things that they have no business deciding. But oftentimes because we're so scared of that, we don't have a super transparent conversation about what they can decide and what they can't. It's like an all or nothing. And so I feel part of a sign of respect is being really clear with people about what they have decision-making power over, what is more something that they can influence, and what is more something that they can advise. And if there is pushback about what's falling into each of those camps, then we can have a conversation about, is there a way to adjust it? Why doesn't that feel right with people? But I mean, I will say it's a tough conversation with the traditional client because many of them are used to keeping things under like a lock and key. But what I try to show them is, in all honesty, the more you can be transparent about such things, the more you actually get people respecting and trusting you. Because if you're not transparent, people just assume you're hiding shit. And that's part of what leads it to evolve, right? So like, if you can actually be honest, even if the honesty is to sort of say, that's a decision I have to make, I can't give over to you, you're actually going to get more respect and more trust than if you don't say that, but do that anyway.
Amazing. So unless anyone else wants to sort of jump in and ask a last question, I want to try and sneak in one maybe final question just to, I don't want to say bump it up a level, but really, I don't know, maybe go really right to the heart of this thing again, which is you said something a number of times in your presentation, Liz, where you sort of spoke to this idea of, you know, if we start with this notion of healing and a recognition that any process of healing has to begin with kind of acknowledgement of trauma, even if that trauma is somehow still ongoing, and invariably that will sort of lead us back to stories and listening to stories, being able to maybe tell stories together, creating stories. And that if these stories are ostensibly effective enough, it may incentivize people to ask questions themselves or maybe eventually take action and say, I want to choose to participate on some level in this process of healing. This is sort of how I took away. Maybe I'm totally wrong, but it sounds sort of well and good. But I think, as you know more than really any of us, is that it's actually super hard to sort of make this, to pull this off. And, you know, we're familiar with these notions of, you know, NIMBYism or, you know, let's do something to make this better until it gets too close to me or until it somehow affects me or until, you know, you had your loop of sort of like, let's just forget about it and just sort of go back, like just don't want to really deal with it. So all of these kinds of issues that are out there, they lead us back to conflict and the fact that, you know, injustice is spatialized because society is unjust and there are certain impulses within human species. So in terms of stories, John, I think Peterson from long ago gave a talk once about, I think it was basically like everything I've done that failed, essentially. My final question is to sort of when in this sort of journey that you've gone on, sort of breaking boundaries and trying to do things in slightly different ways, can you think of an example where it just didn't work, where it just everything ran up against a wall or there was a kind of system breakdown? And did you feel like there's anything maybe that you could sort of learn or extract from that that might also sort of help us when we deal with the sort of really ultimate challenges and the kind of optimistic aspect of this sort of approach of design engagement for social impact? When it really just hits a brick wall, is there anything that you can share from, yeah, these kind of ultimate challenges and how you were able to respond or find a way out, or maybe not?
Yeah. So, you know, two projects that come to mind. One is a project I actually tackled very early in my career when I was working with John at Public Architecture. We had a project called the Day Labor Station, which was a prototype shelter that could be deployed at informal hiring sites. And, you know, the day labor, that issue of day labor sites had been something that we've been looking at Public for a number of years before coming up with this prototype model. And then when we put it out in the world, it kind of blew up. Cooper Hewitt kept it in their Design for the Other 90% exhibit. You know, I was speaking at the National Day Labor Organizing Conference, of which there is one, you know, presenting this. Cities across the country were reaching out to us about it. And it was great. And I had a lot of like super powerful conversations with day laborers across the country and was super excited. I mean, it's a dream project early in your career. And, you know, we figured out sort of the cost of a prototype was to deploy one was roughly $100,000. And we had the unfortunate timing that this came out in about 2007, which was great timing in terms of the immigration conversation, bad timing in terms of the economy. So when the economy collapsed and folks are like cutting essential services, it became politically untenable to have a conversation about hiring sites for what were perceived as undocumented folks, right? And so the project, the thing still was appearing at like the Venice Biennale years later without much effort from us. So in the traditional sort of architecture parlance, the project was a success, right? Like I got a lot of fame and accolades off of it. We won a huge international competition. But in terms of the actual deployment on the ground, it was basically a failure. It was too expensive. It was too big a risk for most people to do, even though they felt it responded to an issue. It just couldn't work in the political or economic climate. And you know, initially I just felt terrible because I was like, but you know, I'm getting, if I just go with the spotlight, I'm getting all of this attention, but like I didn't actually make a difference. And stepping back, I had to actually realize that there were a couple of things that did happen that were super important. This conversation about hiring spaces and that was something that needed to be considered in the conversation and thinking about the dignity of the workers, like that had not actually been a conversation before we started working. And the National Gay Labor Organizing Network did take that on and even took on, we had done a photo series of day laborers and that as a partly advocacy campaign. And so they also were like, oh, there's something here. And so we were able to create that. I also deeply believe that the laborers that I interacted with, no architect had ever come to them before. And so the idea of me just coming and sort of seeing that, saying that I see them as human, I see the spaces that they operate in as important, I think individually was important to them. And then the final thing was like, it was a huge lesson for me of if my work is going to continue to be cutting edge and producing things that have not been seen before, that while I am a good risk taker, that is not true of everybody. And so bringing people along requires smaller steps for people to catch up to the big vision that I can see. And so that's why you see now in a lot of my projects, I often have these like prototyping efforts where we start to test the well. They're like, you know, low risk, high reward things that we can do to build people's confidence to take bigger and bigger risk with what we're proposing. I don't know that I would have ever gotten to that as a practice frame if I hadn't so spectacularly failed with the day labor station. The other project that comes to mind is one connected with Hunters Point. So a couple of years ago, PG&E was ready to start the like kind of longer term visioning process. And so they asked if I would partner with some consultants on that as a separate effort. And so I did initially, and it was, we were also partnering with a different team within PG&E that had not been working with us all these years and been trained up. So they went into autopilot of a very traditional way of doing things and totally did not listen to a single thing that I said. The result is the worst community meeting I have ever participated in my career. I was yelled at, I kind of hung out to dry. There was a lot of emotional damage. And I was like, I basically gave an ultimatum. I said, these are the things that I need to see to have confidence that this can support, this project is aligned with my values. And if it isn't, then I'm gonna step away from this and just stick with the portion of the project that I've been involved in. And so they weren't able to do it. I left and went back to my portion of the project. And, you know, having a community, I mean, I'm sure your professors all have stories of like their worst community meeting. They can tell you about the amounts of therapy they needed to get over it. Like we all have those stories. And I think the important thing is not to like be completely crushed by it or to write it off as a thing that like, oh, you know, it's the community's fault. They just didn't get what we were trying to do for them, right? But like to really take what is the lesson that we can learn. And for me, that meeting was actually the biggest shift in my career to sort of being like, if I'm not centering healing in this conversation, then I'm doing it wrong. And that what I saw there, like despite the years we have been working in the community and the relationships that we've built, it wasn't that people didn't trust that, didn't like trust me, but like I was running up against a huge mountain of grief that continued to be unattended and unresolved. And unless I was willing to incorporate something that would start to think through that, like there was no way that this overall project could move forward. And so that was for me a lesson of, oh, I need to start to learn more about grief and trauma and start to come up with some tools for how to manage it within the context of my projects. And so it's still a work in progress, but I don't know that I would have been so fully put on this path. And I had been seeing it all along, but it took that failed meeting for me to register it as what it was.
Wow, what an incredible takeaway. Liz, thank you so much for being so generous with your time. And I shouldn't be so greedy because this was so delightful, but I can't wait to have you back maybe for a review. Again, thank you from all of us here at the Stuckeman School and the Department of Architecture. Big round of applause for you. Thank you so much. And
thank you.
Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you all. It's been a pleasure. And I hope to see you in person at some point soon.
Thank you, Liz.
Thank you so much.